I'm about to paint on the base colour. I don't want to call it a background colour necessarily because it's just going to be painting underneath to get some colour on the canvas to start off straight away. Although this is just a thin canvas panel that I'm using for this demo. It's pre-primed, so it's got coats of gesso on it, which actually just seal the canvas a little bit. But it's still quite hungry and quite dry, and it will still soak up a fair bit of paint. So it's not a bad idea to get a bit of paint on underneath it to start with. Now, before I go into the colour that I'm going to use, the image that I'm going to be putting on there is of a rosebud. So this is the outline trace image that I'm going to be using today. And I've got it so that it sits, there's the top of the canvas there. I'm yet to decide whether I'll actually put it on a little bit more of an angle or not, but I might just make it simple and pop it up straight like that. So the rosebud itself, I haven't got the reference image here with me at the minute. The rosebud itself has got reds, and mainly reds, greens and yellows in it. So the background colour that I'm going to use, or the undercolour, because like I said, it's actually technically not going to be the final background colour, is something that's going to be fairly bright and that is a colour that may or may not normally be present on the flower. For example, this painting, this one's a bit better of idea. This dog painting that I did has, this is the background colour, but it wasn't the undercolour. The undercolour was that bright, well, you can't see it, but the bright orange colour that's in there. And you can actually see it down the bottom, the very bottom there, there's some of that reddish yellow colour there. And the reason I do that is because I want the painting to surprise me with how it comes together. And sometimes you'll be painting it and you think that you want to map out lots of the colour, block out lots of the colour. And then you look at it and think, oh, wow, that looks really clever. I wouldn't have probably used that colour there, but wow, that really makes it pop. Probably from stopping my logical brain getting in the way of creating a bit more interesting painting. Now, personally, I think that this painting is fabulous because of the colour vibrancy, and that's what I was looking for. The dog painting that I've got in the background there, nowhere near as bright as what that is, but the same sort of process. I've used the yellow underneath mainly in that picture because I was wanting the yellow to present more through the coat. And in the same vein, this is actually a black dog, black and white dog. And I did a hot pink background because the same thing. I wanted to be surprised by little pops of colour that might come break through. And in here, there's a little bit of the hot pink that's come through and just little suggestions of the hot pink. I haven't quite finished this painting, but it's very, very close to being finished. You can see my outline that's still hidden there. And I wasn't planning on keeping the hot pink as a background, but the more I've been away from this painting, the more I actually quite like that hot pink effect. But I'll still probably put another coat on there anyway. But that's what I mean by putting something in the background that's fairly bright and doesn't have to be dark. In fact, it's probably better if it's light and bright rather than just like a dark, bright colour. And it allows then surprises to happen. Getting to putting a little bit of colour on the canvas. One of the nice things about doing the background colour to start with, particularly if you've not been doing much painting or if you're feeling not very confident, it's a great way just to touch the canvas with a brush and feel it and understand what the paint's going to do when you do put it on there without it being any really big drama if it doesn't go right. And of course, there's no such thing as it not going right, because when it comes to the crunch, it's just color and it's just paint, and we can, whatever, if you do something and you mess it up, you can just paint over it. That's what we love about acrylic, because acrylic is quite fast to dry as well. And so therefore it's quite forgiving. So now, not always, but I'm just going to slightly damp down the canvas just to allow the underpaint to travel a little bit easier when I put it on. The other thing is that there's different ways of applying the paint on the canvas. There is obviously with a paintbrush, but you can use other things such as sponges. I sometimes use a card to put it on if I want a bit more texture through it. I'll show you what it looks like with going on with a sponge. The sponge will give it much less coverage, but if you're not in a rush and if you're doing this at your leisure, sometimes it's nice to again see what happens when you put it on with a sponge and what you can do, because it will give it a slightly different texture as well. Trusty, look, I look like I'm ready to do the housework. I've got my rubber gloves on, Wedex. Way more fun than, I don't think they even call them Wedexes anymore. That's what I grew up with, calling them Wedexes. It's a sponge, just a sponge. So I've just cut the sponge into a little piece. Oh, my power's just come back on. I've just got a glass of, it actually is clean water. The jar's just really dirty, but just damp it down a little bit. And on my wet palette, I have put, I don't know whether it's going to flare too much there, a lemon yellow and turquoise with the intention of making a lime green. So when using a lighter colour and a darker colour, to avoid it becoming too dark, because the dark colour will naturally want to override the light colour. So I will use more of the light and just a little touch of the turquoise. In fact, that's probably going to be way too much anyway. So just to see what happens when I mix that up there. And you can see that that's already created quite a nice sort of lime green. So I've only just used the corner of my sponge there and my slightly damp canvas. So I'm actually just going to put that first coat on. And that's just to really show you what you can do just with a sponge, putting a bit of colour over the top of it. Right. So the canvas is dry now, and I'm just going to put another coat on. I'm not sure. You can see that it's sort of a little bit patchy. And while that would actually be quite adequate to start with our painting, I'm actually going to still put another bit of paint on with a brush. Here I am in speedy mode. So all I'm really doing here is covering the canvas with the lime yellow and the turquoise. The majority of the paint that I'll put on there, that I'm using, it's probably 80-20, you know, or maybe even 90-10% of yellow compared to the turquoise. I put a few streaks of the turquoise through it so that I don't want it too even and neat. I flip the canvas around purely because it's a bit easier to paint, and again, it doesn't really matter which direction this colour goes on underneath, because
it's going to have a whole lot more paint over the top of it. The canvas as I'm painting is actually still was feeling quite dry, so I'm glad that I ended up doing a bit more colour over the top of it, putting a bit more paint over the top of it. It's not so much the colour as actually the paint to make it, ultimately it'll make the whole painting feel a little bit more lustrous, because a bit more lush, because you've got more paint covering the canvas by the time I do the painting over the top of it. It's very enjoyable, I've got to say, doing underpaintings. It's very therapeutic.
And there it is, all done, ready to draw up.